G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. In the previous episode of this hand vise build, I made the handle and the cone shaped section that'll push the jaws together. In this episode, I make the main body of the tool that accepts the jaws, pivot screws, and the return springs. Now, as tempting as it is to turn this part from a single piece of rod stock, I've decided to make it as two separate components instead, and then press fit them together at completion. One part is the threaded cylinder that feeds into the threaded cone, and the other is the pivot block that receives the jaws. And you can see that there's some interesting features to be formed for the pivot block that require a bit of forward planning to get a good result. The central hole needs to be sized for that press fit that I mentioned, and the other features must be well centered on the axis of the part for the tool to work correctly. So let's get started. The tool steel that I have on hand is a little oversized for this job, so the first step was to bring that to the correct dimension. The milling throws up a burr on each edge, and I'm being careful to clean them off with this file before proceeding. I'd like to be certain that the wiggler is definitely picking up the true edges of the part and not tripping on the burrs just short of the edge. With the spindle positioned, I opened up the central hole, slightly undersized, and then used a reamer to bring it to final dimension. A quick deburr of the hole, and I can move on with putting in the other features. A wiggler was again used to identify the central axis of the part, and the pivot screw hole positions were drilled all of the way through with the tapping drill size for the screw thread. The same positions were then drilled and reamed half of the way through to the correct clearance size for the shouldered sections of the pivot screws. Next, I used an end mill to carefully mill out the sections that will receive the jaws. Now, the end mill is sticking out only as far as it needs to be to reach down to the bottom of the channel, but it's a very slender cutting tool and at great risk of breaking off and ruining the part, so I'm keeping the cuts modest and the feed rate slow. The holes for the return springs were formed next, using a spot drill to form both holes in the one stroke. Of course, drilling into that central hole unavoidably throws up a small burr, so a few twists with the reamer are required to take it off. The holes for the pivots were then relocated and the thread tapped. So that's the pivot block complete and ready to be pressed onto the threaded insert. Next up is the insert itself, starting with the threads. And I have to admit, I'll take just about any steps to avoid having to mess around with the change gears on my lathes. They really are just so inconvenient. So generally, my preference is to use a die to form a thread up to about 10mm. Beyond that, it gets a bit hard to muscle the die around the work, and even more so when using tool steel like this. So in this case, I don't really have any other choice other than to use the single point method to cut the thread. But before I start making the thread, I do need to do some other preparation. First is the tool itself, which needs to have a 60 degree included angle as well as the appropriate relief clearance formed. A light hone on an oilstone cleans up the small burr left on the top surface by the grinder, and the tool is ready for work. The tool needs to be adjusted in the tool holder to be on center, and the top slide needs to be set to just under 30 degrees. and I definitely can't rely on the graduated scale for this. So I'm setting it exactly using a dial indicator, with the side of the three-jaw chuck as my reference surface. Now there will be quite a bit of side force on the work as this thread is cut, and it's going to be sticking out a long way from the chuck, so tailstock support will be essential. A number 3 centre drill was used to cut the centre hole, and this live centre will provide the support. From here, I can turn the profile of the stock in preparation for forming the thread. The threading tool is now mounted on the tool post and then set square to the work. Now, single point threading is a process of repetition. And I don't mind admitting, it takes all of my concentration to stay focused on getting that process correct. It begins with the cutter just touching the work, at which point the handwheel collars are set to zero. The split nut is then engaged with the lead screw to set the carriage in motion. Now this first pass barely marks the work, but it's a great opportunity to confirm that all is as it should be with the thread pitch. Once confirmed, the tool is retracted and the carriage returned to a position just prior to the starting point of the thread. The cross slide is returned to the zero position, and then a small cut is put on by winding in the top slide handwheel. With each successive pass, the cut is gradually increased by continuing to feed in with the top slide, and the process is repeated until the thread is formed to full depth. And I should point out that this particular lathe has no threading dial. So unlike those lathes that do have a threading dial, it's essential that the split nut is kept engaged with the lead screw at all times. And I'm keeping my finger positioned right on the stop button to be sure to catch the tool as it passes into the relief groove at the end of each pass. It's surprisingly easy to let the tool run on too far and spoil the work. I'm using this nut as a simple gauge to judge my progress. I know it to be a loose fit on a standard thread, so if it passes on, I know I'm close to the correct minor diameter. In this case, it'll start, but it won't continue onto the thread, so I'm still short of the full depth. A few more light passes though, and it goes on beautifully. The threaded cone is a slightly tighter fit than this nut, so a few more light passes are required to bring the thread to final dimension. The end of the thread needs a quick tidy up, so I took care of that next. And if you look closely, you can see that I've just nicked the bottom of the clearance groove. It wasn't quite at the correct depth, so that also needs a quick tidy up. And with that operation complete, the tailstock support was removed and the work parted off. Okay, so I mentioned that I'll be fixing these two parts together with a press fit, and I need some guidance on an appropriate oversized dimension for the spigot. Machinery's handbook tells me that in this case, something like 1.5 hundredths of a millimeter over the reamed dimension will give me a nice locational interference fit. So that's the dimension that I'm shooting for over the nominal figure. A light chamfer will help me when it comes to the press fit, and with the outside diameter finalised, I can drill out the centre hole. And while I'm here, this is my last good opportunity to cleanly access that shoulder section. So now's the time to bring up the surface finish. The drill exit hole has a decent burr too, so the part was reversed and a countersink cutting tool used to remove it. So with most of the features for these parts formed, it's time to press them together. And I'm using this arbor press to do the job. I'm holding the pivot block using a simple drilling vise. It'll make it easier for me to hold the part and keep the block upright and square with the action of the arbor press. And just like that, the two parts are joined for good. The design calls for the outer ends to be radiused around the pivots, so I mark that out next. The belt sander brings the work to the line, and I finish the ends off by using a 400 grit belt end on to leave a grained finish along the length of the curve. A little time on some abrasive paper puts a similar grained finish on the flat surfaces. And I've used abrasive stones to break the corners of the part. It's less aggressive than using a fine cut file, and for something small like this, I find they give me a more consistent result across the whole part. The part fits nicely into the handle of the tool, and the thread has an excellent smooth feel. Up close, you can see the purpose of undercutting the thread in the previous episode. It lets the insert fit snugly inside the vise as it's fully closed. And that's the main body of the tool complete. In the next video, I'll make the pivot screws and the return springs. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.